My name is Oscar Bruno from Vijfde, and I am the director of the Transnational NGO Initiative at the Monument Institute of Global Affairs from the Radboud School. We focus on the role of transnational NGOs and other forms of civil society, such as social movements, including faith-based social movements in global governance. And we're particularly interested in the governance of such organizations, their leadership and their effectiveness. And every year we invite a range of speakers, sometimes scholars, sometimes practitioners, and today we're lucky enough to have some of the richest both scholarship and practice. And today we're going to focus on the phenomena of faith-based social movements and their role in the global civil society, through focusing on the HISMAT movement as a transnational social movement, or the Kulin movement. Our guest, Mr. Al Flanagan, the president of the Alliance for Shared Values, will talk to us about the HISMAT movement as an example of faith-based global civil society. The Alliance for Shared Values is a nonprofit here in the US that's one of the organizations, in fact, it acts, as Al explained to me this morning, as an umbrella, it acts amongst others as an umbrella organization for about six or so nonprofit organizations in the US that are under the HISMAT movement, if you will. The HISMAT movement is very much started in Turkey, is now very much global. In fact, you're operating in around 100 countries, right? Both in humanitarian relief work, in building and running of private schools, and in medical work. And the movement has a very interesting set of values that are aimed on interfaith dialogue and intercultural dialogue. So to enhance the understanding of people from different faiths and different cultures and different parts of the world through action. So being inspired by faith to engage in action, as Al explained to me this morning. This talk is not going to be focused so much on the role of the HISMAT movement in Turkey, and including on what is currently very contentious in terms of the relationship between the Turkish government and the HISMAT movement. We are interested in this talk in its role as a faith-based global movement, if you will, and some of the organizational features and the effectiveness issues, etc. We already undertook a short interview that was recorded for our website, so in about a week, so if you go to the Transnational NGO Initiative website, you will see that short interview. Also, you can point your students to that. We are also recording this whole talk for our YouTube channel, so you can, those of you in class, etc., who cannot attend today, can watch it that way. So, Albus has an interesting background because he has a PhD in computer science from the University of Illinois at Chicago and was a faculty member at the University of Texas at Arlington, as well as at Prairie View A&M University. And from that stance in academia, he became 3 years ago the executive director of the Alliance for Shared Values. In the talk, he'll spend a little bit about the nature of the HISMAT movement as a transnational movement, its social and institutional leadership, its organizational structure, its governance, and its effectiveness issues. And Mr. Flanagan will try to also compare and contrast, as I understand it, the nature of the HISMAT movement with that of other social movements in the world, including faith-based as well as secular movements. So thank you very much.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks for having me and for this opportunity to talk about a topic that I think lies at the intersection of our interests around humanity, the shared values of humanity. My talk will be a mixture of some talk and some visuals. So as appropriate, I'll try to show you the work of the movement participants. Some years ago, a friend of mine reminded me that if you are new to a phenomenon, a group of people who are doing something, then a good criterion for understanding them is to look at what their work is. Thou shalt know them by their fruits, what kind of tree it is. So I'll try to show you some examples of the work of the movement participants. I'd like to start with a couple of quotes from Martin Luther King Jr., because sometimes Hizmet movement in Turkey is referred to as the equality or civil rights movement of Turkey. On many aspects, there are striking similarities. Of course, there are also differences. I'll try to come to that in the comparison section. So Martin Luther King Jr. said, and I quote, "Those who are not looking for happiness are the most likely to find it, because those who are searching forget that the surest way to be happy is to seek happiness for others." The second quote is from his acceptance speech at the Nobel lecture in 1964 in Oslo. "There is a sort of poverty of the spirit which stands in glaring contrast to our scientific and technological abundance. The richer we have become materially, the poorer we have become morally and spiritually. We have learned to fly the air like birds and swim the sea like fish, but we have not learned the simple art of living together as brothers." So, Gülen or Hizmet movement, Gülen movement is a term that is preferred by social scientists in the West, and Hizmet is one of the terms used by participants. Another term popular in Turkey is camia, which is, in a sense, a broader, wider, more porous border version of community. Might be translated as society. It is a movement that seeks to combine personal spiritual growth with social action. That is, as people try to develop themselves, their spiritual potential, they also try to translate that growth into social action in terms of serving others, helping others achieve their potential. This is the basic, essential premise of the movement. From a few individuals around Mr. Gülen, who was a preacher in the city of Izmir in Turkey, the movement grew today to millions of people, a small community of faithful citizens who want to do something about the society around them. The movement turned into a transnational movement starting in the 80s and especially 90s, with activities in over 160 countries today and hundreds of NGOs. Before I go into the examples of work and the answers to the questions or discussions of the questions that Tosca pointed out, I'd like to refer those interested to some theoretical models. These theoretical models are suggested by social scientists who studied the movement. For instance, the new social movement theory, led by Turan, I might be mispronouncing, Melucci, and others, is suggested as an effective model to understand the movement, the new social movement theory. So in this new social movement theory, the social aspect is seen as important or more important than economic and political aspects. The movement emphasizes, new social movements emphasize, the post-material values as opposed to simply material values. They consist of an informal, loosely organized social network of supporters rather than members. Their key actors are likely to come from the middle class rather than the lower classes. And finally, they are not interested in just one single issue, and they last longer. Some just three characteristics of new social movements that match Hizmet movement. Sociologist Dr. Helen Rose Iba from University of Houston suggested that resource mobilization theory of John McCarthy, Mayer Zolt, and others is a good theory to understand the resource mobilization within the movement. So according to this theory, there is always enough discontent, I'm quoting, there is always enough discontent in a society to provide grassroots support for a movement. But to focus and organize the discontent into a social movement it is necessary for a core group of sophisticated strategists to organize to harness those disaffected people, to attract money and supporters, to capture the media's attention, and forge alliances with those in power and create an organizational structure. So they give the details of this theory and how it applies to the movement in their work, Dr. Helen Rosiba. And she also argues that organizational commitment theory of Rosabeth Kanter is a good model to understand the movement. Finally, Dr. Elizabeth Özdalga, the former head of the Swedish Institute in Istanbul, in her article in Muslim World Special Issue, Muslim World Journal Special Issue focused on the movement, she suggested that British sociologist Norbert Elias's work on established versus the outsider. This is his theory. Established versus the outsider theory is helpful for understanding the reactions, the responses to the movement in Turkish society. So if you're interested, I will be happy to share more details about these theoretical models with you. The movement seeks to combine personal spiritual growth with the social action. And when this transformation, this reflection takes place, it is reflected in primarily into two domains. All right, we'll try again. All right. So in the personal dimension of the movement, there are efforts to help individuals grow themselves spiritually. So there are conversation circles, there is learning going on, publications. There is a sense of community. The community is around spiritual conversations and also around social work. And there is always outreach to bring the key values and the premise of the movement to new people and invite them to participate. In the social sphere, volunteerism and giving is a big element. And these are channeled into various kinds of projects, examples of which I will share with you. In the social sphere, there is also outreach and, of course, the service itself. This is just one recent example from the relief work in Sandy, which happened in the East Coast a few years ago. And here, a few movement volunteers are standing with former President Bill Clinton as they work there to help the victims of Sandy. Just as a side note, President Clinton actually has a comment on Mr. Gulen's contribution to interfaith understanding, which is accessible on YouTube. In this picture, I try to combine examples of various kinds of work. The first is a women's action group that runs a TV program. They run multiple women organizations that mobilize resources of women to help with the social causes. This one is an example of medical work that is done in Africa. This one is an example of educational work that is done in Southeast Turkey, the Kurdish majority population region. And this is an example of relief work. And these are students from and teachers from an international school outside of Turkey. The activities of the movement participants essentially span these areas, education being the foremost one, professional associations, disaster relief, economic assistance, interfaith and intrafaith, intercultural dialogue, healthcare, publications, and media. Here are pictures of some well-known people who have become participants to some degree in Turkey. And they come from very different backgrounds. Some of them are non-Muslim. They have mixed ethnic origins. Some of them are technically Muslim, but not observant. And the basic premise of the movement is that people can come around shared values from different backgrounds. Although our backgrounds and roots may be different, we can still come around these shared values. So this is just a graphic symbolization of that premise. And there's a story that I published in a book that I co-edited, which is available in this book, Muslim Citizens of the Globalized World, which describes the shared value of protecting our youth from self-destructive habits that took place in Romania between the Romanian parent and the Turkish school administration. All right. Some of the shared values that movement participants believe in and believe fellow humans can gather around include these: human dignity and commitment to human dignity, belief in the inherent worth of every human being, equality as a consequence of that, freedom from all forms of oppression, empathic acceptance of differences, nonviolence, upholding the rule of law, dialogue versus stereotyping. These values can be found in Gulen's literature, but also in the broader Turkish Muslim literature as far as the movement participants' sources are concerned. So the movement started, as I mentioned, as a small community of faithful citizens around Mr. Gulen as a preacher. And sometimes we jokingly say that it was fortunate that he was a preacher, because reading is not really something that contemporary Turks are known for. So if he was a writer, he would probably have one-tenth of an impact that he has today. So he was a preacher, but he was a maverick preacher, and he rallied people around him, around the cause of education, for the purpose of addressing the three primary social ills that the country and the society were facing. And these were, of course, lack of quality education, ignorance, the division and the violent conflicts that people were suffering. Literally, thousands of Turkish youth, died in the 70s in Turkey, around the time when Gulen began his social advocacy. And the lack of opportunity and equality, that is, ongoing profiling and discrimination in government institutions against citizens of certain backgrounds and worldviews. So Gulen's approach was to invest in education as a means of countering these social ills in a positive, non-confrontational way. After the first informal social network formed, various activities, projects, and institutions came to life. One of the first activities was scholarships for students. Students who could not otherwise afford to get a higher education were supported. Some student residences were supported so that students, college students, could come together and live together in homes. Then dormitories were built, again, for students. College prep centers helped students get into the university because there was just a single central exam through which all students went into the university. So it was very crucial, and success in that exam was very crucial. So college prep centers were established. Private schools were established, higher education institutions, and then humanitarian relief institutions, publication houses, and professional organizations. Professional in the sense of spanning essentially all sectors, from doctors, nurses, to writers and journalists, to businessmen, to blue-collar workers. In my view, Gulen's role, and I will come back to this under leadership, but in my view, Gulen's role in the formation of the movement was functioning as a seed for mobilizing, re-energizing the dormant energies in the Turkish society. When I say Turkish, I mean Turkish, Kurdish, and all other ethnicities, Anatolian society. So, would like to give this analogy to better understand this concept. I have done the saturation experiment. I'm not sure if you have done the saturation experiment in high school. That is, you put water into a container and you begin to heat that container and add water to it, add sugar to it. So as you heat the water, its capacity to dissolve sugar increases. So you put more sugar and more sugar. And at some point, it reaches saturation. Then you begin to cool down the water. And when you reach near the freezing temperatures, you release a small crystal of sugar into the container. And if you continue to cool down, you see that a big, really big sugar crystal forms around that original seed crystal. So I liken Gulen and the people around him, their role into this seed crystal. That is, none of the values that the movement cherishes were invented by Gulen. And he did not turn people into simply better people.
But he represented an example, and the people around him represented examples. They started projects, and people saw them as trustworthy individuals. And they saw that the projects were viable. And the dormant energies in them, the energies for donations, financial donations, the energies for volunteering, the energy for outreach, expansion, all these dormant energies were channeled into these projects and into these NGOs. Now, after a while, after the formation of the institutions and NGOs, the movement began a transnational phase. This transnational phase happened at the junction of three phenomena. The first one was the Özal era in Turkey. That is, Prime Minister first and then President Özal opened Turkey up into the globe, into the world. So Turkish economy liberalized and opened up. Turkish society opened up. Turkish politics opened up. As a result of this opening, movement participants began visiting and moving into other countries, Central Asia, Europe, other parts of the world. So this is one phenomenon that allowed mobility of the movement participants and resources. The second phenomenon was the movement was getting bigger, the human resources were getting larger and larger. And the third phenomenon was the collapse of the Soviet Union. So as a result of the junction of these three phenomena, in the Central Asian republics, Turkic republics, that is, their populations speak a dialect of Turkish, they are culturally similar to Turkey, not the same, but similar to Turkey, there were opportunities there to establish educational institutions. So merchants, business people, together with educators, visited and then moved to these countries to establish first institutions in those countries. Now, in doing this, what was their motivation? One motivation was the concept of proactive involvement in globalization. That is, it was becoming obvious to most people that globalization is here to stay. Therefore, Glenn's approach was, because it's going to be here to stay, we can either passively try to accept it, or we can become proactive actors, agents in globalization. So he was encouraging people to actually invest in other countries for businessmen and also for educators to consider starting institutions in other countries. In terms of people themselves, the notion of temsil, that is representation, representing your values, your cultural values or religious values in another geography and finding people, similarly minded people, and forming projects and institutions in those regions were attractive. So at the junction of these three dynamics, the transnationalization began. So today, what originally started as essentially a Turkish Muslim movement, today in some countries there are no Turks left. So the NGOs are run by local people who are not Turkish, mostly still Muslim. In some institutions, we see non-Muslim leaders, not in high positions, but ideally we expect that as the time proceeds, in higher leadership positions, we should be seeing non-Muslim individuals as well. At least that is the premise of the movement, and we will see how, to what degree that will materialize. Now, in terms of the movement's strategies regarding recruitment, motivation, and participation, for the initial group of people, the recruitment was essentially people interested in Gulen's preaching. That is, as a maverick preacher, he was first of all very logical. He had strong rhetorical skills, but he was also non-confrontational. He always defended the upholding the rule of law and democracy. He was at peace with democracy, arts, sciences, which was attractive to people like myself who loved science and arts and music and democracy. So this was the initial attraction. But after the initial attraction with Gulen's advocacy, projects started. Conversation circles started. So people began seeing actually in concrete and in human activity, their resources being utilized. So those activities, projects, institutions, work began attracting other people. After this stage, the institution began producing graduates or actually helping society. So people affected from the work of the institutions began became new participants. So the graduates of the schools, the graduates of the college prep centers became new participants. I met personally many people in Turkey. I'm not like that, but many people told me that they benefited when they were a student from the Hizmet's educational institutions, and when they graduated, they felt the in an inner obligation to contribute to other students, to establish scholarships, or to donate to a school. In terms of the motivation mechanisms, definitely there's the religious element and the cultural element, or elements, I should say. And I argue that there are also some psychosocial elements. So if you're going to call the first set of elements idealistic elements, there are also some somewhat more pragmatic elements. Let me explain that. In terms of the psychological, religious and cultural elements, for instance, there is the concept of rıza, or in Arabic, rida, which means the pleasure of God or the approval of God. That is, God loves creation, God loves humanity, God loves believers, but God is also pleased with certain actions of human beings, and he is displeased with certain actions of human beings. I'm trying to convey the understanding as far as the Muslim participants are concerned. So certain actions of ours are pleasing to God and certain are not. Therefore, for a human being to achieve its full potential, to fulfill the purpose of creation for himself or herself, to choose those actions that are pleasing to God is preferable, and it is also spiritually fulfilling. For instance, helping a student get a scholarship so that they can study, or establishing a dormitory so that a student in a village can move to a town where they can attend high school. We are talking about 70s in Turkey. This is pleasing to God. Or simply going to a location where they don't have access to medical services as a doctor, as a nurse, and providing them with these services, regardless of the faith of the people there, regardless of the ethnic background. This act by itself is pleasing to God, rıza. So this rıza concept is the key primary religious motivator for Muslim movement participants. There are other elements that may be a little bit more peripheral. For instance, the concepts of zakah and sadaqah for financial donations. So every Muslim is obligated to donate a portion of their wealth anyway. And so most Muslim participants will donate to movement institutions. The sadaqah is the optional extra charity that is not obligatory. It is encouraged, but it is not obligatory. So that could also be channeled to projects. Another concept in motivation is the spiritual conversation circle. There is the sohbet in Turkish and Arabic. Sohbet means a group of people coming together, reading and discussing and conversing around spiritual texts. It could be the stories of Prophet's life, the stories of peace be upon him, stories of his friends, or it could be stories of the virtuous scholars and leaders of the past. So around these conversations, again, there is motivation to do work. Another important concept in both motivation and organization is the concept of himmet and mütevelli. Himmet means the fundraising meeting. So this himmet concept of financially giving to somebody in need or some project in need or some institution in need was already there. So all of these concepts that I'm talking about, they were already in the Turkish Muslim culture and religious tradition. And the concept of mütevelli is essentially like a board of trustees or board of directors, a group of people who might be founders of an NGO, who might be financial donors of an NGO, who might be simply volunteers of an NGO, who might be outreach people who bring more people to the NGO. But these are people who are stakeholders, so they form this group. If it is formalized, it actually becomes the board of directors of an NGO. But sometimes it remains informal, and in that sense, it is known as mütevelli. In terms of the organizational structures within the movement, according to Dr. Elizabeth Özdalga, the Swedish sociologist, the movement can best be described as a conglomerate of social networks and NGOs. So within the sphere of the movement, there are informal social networks and semi-formalized social networks. There are NGOs or SMOs, social movement organizations. These could be charitable foundations. They could be professional organizations. And often, these two groups of organizations work together. And there are also some companies, for-profit companies. Now, this area is a little interesting because you would expect in a social movement to have non-profit organizations usually. The fact that there are for-profit companies is a result of Turkish history, because Turkey has experienced four military coups. And in some of these coups, the military junta members, the administration, actually confiscated the properties of charitable foundations. So in the days leading to a potential military coup, some of the non-profit organizations were turned into companies, and some of them remained companies. So the social networks, the informal, semi-formal social networks, are in constant interaction with the NGOs and the professional organizations. They provide the outreach activities. They provide the motivation for funding. The NGOs may have formal committees and people who do those, but informal social networks work in tandem with them. For instance, the Kimse Yok Mu Relief Agency, whose work I'm going to show you in a moment, they have... I believe in the order of over 100,000 or 200,000 volunteers. These are official volunteers on their books. But probably they actually benefit from twice or three times as many people depending on the project. So there are both informal and formal networks of people who work with these NGOs. In terms of the leadership of these NGOs, at the formation of the NGOs, the initial leadership is in a sense decided by that group of people who were the leaders in forming that NGO. Let's say we have a financial donor or a group of financial donors. We have education activists, educators, who are social advocates. And we have simply concerned parents, a group of people. So this first group of people form the first social network around the school, let's say, or around the dormitory, around some other institution. And they form, they decide the first official formal board of directors of the NGO. And then from then on, the future of the organization is decided by that formal board of directors with feedback and input from the informal support group. Now, Gülen, of course, as a spiritual person, as a scholar and preacher, he plays a special role, which probably will not be replaced by anybody. But other types of leadership are available and are present within the movement. For instance, there are many people who are either self-trained or formally educated, they provide the leadership in spiritual conversations to groups of people, sometimes tens of thousands of people. Some of them are also writers. They have books and they have newspaper columns. So this is the spiritual leadership side. In the social leadership side, for each NGO, there is both formal leadership in the form of having a role in the organization itself, or in the social network or networks that work in tandem with that NGO. In those social networks, there are also informal leadership positions. So despite Gülen's special role, other forms of spiritual and social and institutional leadership are open to people, and they take up those roles. Maybe at this point, let me go back to the work and give you show you some examples. This is a graphic summarizing what I just shared with you, movement having informal and formal social networks and NGOs, and the forms of spiritual, social, and institutional leadership. So spiritual leadership will take place in conversation circles, in mentoring, in publications and media, and social leadership will take place in NGOs, volunteering, fundraising, and in outreach. And the institution will take place in the official organizational hierarchy. All right. Okay, I think I'll need to switch. All right. So these are going to be some examples from the humanitarian work. Kimse Yok Mu is the central big humanitarian relief organization based in Turkey. It has many, many siblings in many countries, but these smaller organizations such as Embrace Relief in the United States work in tandem with Kimse Yok Mu because Kimse Yok Mu is able to channel and mobilize so many resources. in great magnitudes. To give you an idea, it was founded in 1999 after a big earthquake in Turkey, which cost the lives of thousands of people. So around the rubbles, people were screaming, "Kimse yok mu?" Which means, "Isn't there anybody out there who can help me?" So "Kimse yok mu?" literally in Turkish means, "Isn't there anybody out there?" Initially, a TV program was started to help the victims of the earthquake, and then this TV program, in a sense, gave birth to the relief agency that is now Kimse Yok Mu. Today, they have over 1,000 projects. Many of them are ongoing projects in over 100 countries. They reached millions of people in every year. So this is their latest official volunteer number, but you know, in fact, the real number is much larger than this. And last time we visited their headquarters, they told us that their budget changes from year to year depending on the disasters and their fundraising campaigns, but it changes between $60 to $100 million. And they are subject to scrutiny by Turkish government, and which requires the charitable foundations to have at least 90% efficiency rate. So they actually passed that. Examples of projects of Kimse Yok Mu and Embrace Relief. This is the Water Wells project, and I will give you statistics in a moment. So they provide water wells, storage facilities, sewage treatment plants, water network systems, and more importantly, they maintain what they built, which is as important to the people locally there as building them. Their water well project soared within the last few years from a few into 2,261. This is a distribution of the countries where the water wells were made. Pakistan leads, and then Chad, Cameroon. In bringing these services, it is open. It is intended to serve everybody, regardless of religious or ethnic background. Raise an Orphan campaign. They solicit funds from donors, and they also establish mechanisms and institutions so that these orphans can be supported for the longer term. Many of these wars and refugee situations create, unfortunately, tens of thousands of orphans. So currently, they claim to care for about 60,000 orphans in 56 countries. Orphanages in Burundi, in Senegal. An important activity area, maybe the foremost activity area, is education, as I mentioned. And bringing education to girls is also primary. It's a focus activity. So in regions like Afghanistan and Pakistan, there are schools and girls' schools because of the local demand there. And they bring both scientific education, social sciences, and arts and language education to those geographies. Ethiopia and Kenya, educational institutions, scholarships. Medical centers and hospitals in several locations. This one is in Uganda, there's one in Kenya, there's one in northern Iraq. The cataract project served tens of thousands of people, giving back their vision. So for instance, this project is a good example of the collaboration between different NGOs. Kimse Yok Mu is a relief agency. They don't employ any doctors, maybe just a few. But there is a doctor's professional association which has thousands of members. So that NGO and Kimse Yok Mu will work together to bring the doctors into that locality which needs the services. But then they also need the medicine, medications, right? So then the professional business association will come into the picture. They will provide the funds to support the medications. So by bringing together volunteers, financial donors, and the doctors and the nurses, they can implement a medical service project. Okay, I think this gives a good idea. All right. The financing of the projects can be considered under these three categories. The charitable foundations, they can collect funds as the charitable foundations do here. They do fundraising drives in Turkish called Himmet. They usually occur during the month of Ramadan, in which Muslims believe that their charitable donations are more valuable. So they are kind of concentrated in the month of Ramadan, but it is not limited to the month of Ramadan. Other examples of campaigns include donation of sacrificial animals. So instead of slaughtering a sacrificial animal themselves, they will donate the money, and the sacrifice will be done in a region where there is a need for food, so the meat will be distributed. And in-kind donations is also an important element of the financial picture. The professional organizations charge membership dues. They also do fundraising drives, and they also provide pro bono work drives. A few years ago, I visited Turkey and visited a women's organization. It was a kind of an interest-based organization. I met a lady who was an architect. She told me that she is doing the architectural work of a village rebuilding effort in Sudan. She said, this is my contribution to the broader social effort of the movement. All right, so let's talk about the leadership and the faith-based character or faith-inspired character of the movement. Gulen began his life, professional life as a preacher, as a state-licensed preacher. In Turkey, to be able to serve as an imam or as a preacher, you have to be state-licensed. This is something that may be a little hard to understand for people who think of Turkey as a secular country. Turkish understanding of secularism is modeled after France. France in the 1800s and early 1900s. That is, it is not necessarily neutral to religion or religions. It is a little hostile and seeking the control of religion. For instance, from the 1930s on, the government has been running every single mosque and paying every single imam and often telling them what to preach. You know, it will be hard to even imagine for you living in the United States. So that definitely would not count as secularism. On the other hand, in terms of freedoms, simple things such as wearing a silver ring for a male or having the signs of praying five times a day could disqualify you from a position for which you are qualified. I might have a degree, I might be fully qualified for a government position, but I'm talking about until the last two decades. But if somebody notices my silver ring, they might think, okay, he is a male who is wearing a silver wedding ring. It is not a golden ring, which means he is an observant Muslim, because observant Muslim men don't wear golden rings. Therefore, he's an observant Muslim. Therefore, he's a threat to the regime. Therefore, he cannot get this job. In some institutions, they would even go underneath your pants to check the marks of praying under your knees. So there are thousands of such accounts. Another example is my grandmother's example. I'm talking about the Turkish implementation of so-called secularism, which is more laïcité, modeled after France. So when I was learning how to read the Quran, I noticed something. I loved my grandmother. She was, you know, the grandmother. She cooked things for you, cookies for you. You know, she gave you tips all the time, and she was on your side in every argument. She was that kind of woman. So one day I noticed that I'm reading the Quran, but she is not. But she's an observant lady. I mean, she covered and she was praying and everything, but she was not reading the Quran. So I noticed that and I asked her, Grandma, why are you not reading the Quran? And she said, my dear, I don't know how to read the Quran. I was puzzled. Well, how do you do your prayers then? She said, I just memorize a few verses from the Quran. Then I asked, why? Why didn't you learn? She said, I didn't have the opportunity because when I was a child, it was a crime to teach and learn the Quran. In our village, if the gendarmerie, military police, caught somebody teaching the Quran, they could get beaten and even jailed. So I couldn't learn the Quran. We didn't have a modern school. I couldn't learn the modern Latin alphabet, so I didn't learn to read anything. So as you can agree, this is nothing to do with secularism. It is neither freedom nor neutrality. It is hostile control of religious practice. Things improved within the last few decades, but there are still problems. The government still runs all the mosques, for instance. In one sense, some people argue it is good so that there's no radicalization, but there is room for improvement. So the faith-based character of the movement, Gulen started as a preacher. He was addressing initially, and to this day, predominantly Muslim audiences. So his elements, dynamics, were coming from essentially religious sources, but also from humanitarian sources. Gulen himself is well-read in Western literature, from Kant to Pascal to Hume to other people that you can imagine as great Western thinkers. He is well-versed in them, so sometimes you will see elements of Western thought being incorporated into his sermons. For instance, he would talk about the experiential knowledge. I believe Kant talks about that, that certain things are impossible to really know unless you experience them. So in Gulen's preaching, there was religious elements, and also there was the humanitarian element. But from the get-go, the premise was that these values that we cherish as Muslims are not unique to Muslims. We reach them, we come to them from our Muslim roots, but a Buddhist may come to the same value from the Buddhist roots. They may call it karma, I may call it rıza. Well, if we agree on the practical, operational definition of something, then that's sufficient. We don't have to agree on theological understanding of it. Even people within their traditions can't agree on it anyway. Right? So people can come from Jewish or Christian or agnostic humanitarian backgrounds. If we agree on the operational definition, then we can work together. That is the premise. And it seems to be working because increasingly in movement-affiliated NGOs, there are more non-Turks and non-Muslims. So the movement, as was suggested, is not necessarily faith-based. In reality, practically today, it is still 99% Turkish, Kurdish, Muslim. But it is not a necessary requirement for participation. Anybody can participate as long as there's an agreement on the core values. I think it will take time for the non-Muslim, non-Turkish participants to increase in their numbers and percentage, and it might take quite some time for them to reach leadership, high leadership positions. So it is a faith-inspired movement rather than a faith-based movement, which is seeking to realize this premise of being a humanitarian, human movement. Let me come back to the leadership question. So Gulen, as a spiritual leader, has initially been the engine or the motor of the projects and the NGOs. Right? But increasingly, he could no longer function in that role. First, because of the size, and secondly, because of his health situation. So increasingly, Gulen's role was reduced into more of an inspirational and motivational role. So today, he will occasionally speak for about 45 minutes, maybe twice a week, and he'll talk about some contemporary topics. Mostly he will talk about everlasting, evergreen tree topics, such as sincerity, such as devotion, such as serving others. Seeking happiness in the happiness of others is a theme that he talks about again and again. So he is today serving as an inspirational and motivational role. Occasionally, institutional leaders, NGO leaders might visit with him and seek his advice or opinion on certain matters. But he often actually delegates even that to a group of people, experts or stakeholders who will give their opinions. So he will not, for instance, he will refrain from saying his opinion directly. He will instead ask people around him. I witnessed this many times. So this is the tradition of consultation, which allows for leaders to emerge within both the informal and the formal structures. Should conclude? Okay, all right. So. Let me show you a few more pictures and talk about the analogy with the other movements a little bit and finish there. Right. So this picture is from a school in the city of Bursa. As you can see, people are not covered. In some schools, they might be covered. It totally depends on the population. So there's no requirement of any religious observance. Everybody is welcome. But in this case, their parents may be observant. They may not be observant, but they like what the school stands for. You might not be able to tell, but they are actually in a music class singing, and it is not a girls-only school. This is a co-ed, but all the boys were actually, I was in this room, they were all sitting over this side. In this particular picture, you see a girl who won a medal in a social science. You can hardly see social science Olympiads. There's an emphasis on social science in addition to the physical sciences because you need a balance and also arts. This is a school in southeast Turkey, the predominantly Kurdish population. There is a college prep center that that are very happy because their students got into the medical school. So all of these students who attended this college prep center went into the medical school. This is a free educational service, a tutoring center, which again allows the impoverished kids there, mostly Kurdish, but doesn't have to be, Turkish and Arabic and other ethnicities. The tutoring centers allow them, help them to get into better schools, score better in exams, and otherwise improve themselves in academic and non-academic skills. The girls' version of the tutoring center, again in the same region. So Turkey's population is roughly 15 to 20% Kurdish, and the rest is Turkish. There are other small ethnicities. Within Hizmet movement, a similar percentage can be seen. There is a significant minority of Kurdish participants. A school from Pakistan, a university higher education in Turkey, a medical school. You can see both covered and uncovered students there. This is the group of ladies I was talking about. They run this program where they discuss both social and family issues. They provide the perspective of a doctor, medical doctor, a psychologist, and a teacher. A hospital in Istanbul, a hospital in Şanlıurfa, which is only a few tens of miles from the Syrian border. So this was started many years ago, and even at that day, it was serving Turkish, Kurdish, Arabic, Iranian even patients. So it continues to serve in that capacity. It was formed, it was established by a Kurdish family who have doctors and pharmacists in their among their children. They are movement participants. And examples of disaster relief, first which I have shown already. So let me conclude with a brief look at the comparisons with other social movements. In understanding a new social phenomenon, unless you know the analogy, the other part of the analogy, you really don't understand the new phenomenon either. So in the past, social scientists have done comparisons with movements such as the Focolare movement based in Italy, the Kolping movement based in Germany, Rishoe, and I might be butchering this, Rishoe Kosei Kai movement based in Japan, I believe, a Buddhist movement. So comparative studies were done comparing Hizmet movement or contrasting Hizmet movement with those movements. So for American audiences, I find the civil rights movement analogy more helpful because many people are familiar with this analogy. And let me talk about the others if time allows. So in the case of these two movements, their key concepts and themes are very similar. Education for liberation in form of empowering people to achieve their full potential. Equality, equal opportunity, spiritual growth, and everything. So recognition of and commitment to the inherent worth, dignity, and equality of all humans is at their core, both of these movements. In terms of the goal and activity areas, they work in equality, equal opportunity, equal justice space. They also emphasize personal spiritual growth. As Martin Luther King would argue, the social scene will not reflect unless people are transformed. Community improvement and also dialogue and mutual respect. In terms of the historic backdrop, the civil rights movement was against the backdrop of racially driven discrimination and oppression and segregation. In the case of the Hizmet movement, it was, in Turkish context, it was ideologically driven. That is, the state adopted an official ideology. And regardless of who you are, if you don't embrace the official ideology, you could be in trouble. This official ideology is enshrined in Turkish constitution. And I was giving this analogy to Tosca that imagine, you know, after the next election, a powerful president of the political persuasion that you don't like becomes a president. You know, so if you're a Democrat, you don't like the other side. If you're a Republican, you don't like the other side. Imagine a president and the Congress and the Senate all are composed of the same mentality. And they decide this is the time to change our constitution. and conservatism or liberalism or take your pick is going to become our official ideology of United States of America. And if you are not embracing that ideology, you're in trouble. That is, what does that mean? That means if we see signs of your not embracing official ideology, you'll be profiled, you'll be discriminated against. You will not have equal opportunity. If you run a business, don't hope for government contracts. So his met social dimension in forms of educational empowerment was addressing this issue. It was not solely devoted to that, but it was an important element of the struggle of people. In terms of the methods that are used in the civil rights movement, we see nonviolent civil disobedience, marches, boycott sit-ins. We see the legal struggle, media advocacy, and grassroots NGO activism. In the case of Hizmet movement, it's a little different. There is no disobedience, but there is nonviolent advocacy. So breaking the rule, breaking the law in a nonviolent way has not been used. But rather than that, pushing for changing the law has been used. So legal struggle, legal advocacy, and social advocacy have been used. Education in both sides, media advocacy in both sides, and grassroots NGO activism in both sides. In terms of the individuals who are seen as the spiritual inspiration leaders of the movements, they were both preachers, they were social advocates. They brought religiously rooted universal values into social action. And they were loved by many, but also seen as many as controversial while they were alive. I didn't know this, and I was told by a friend in Houston who was a friend of Martin Luther King Jr., Reverend Bill Lawson, who runs the Lawson Center in Houston. So one day, as a Turkish graduate student who came to America, I always thought everybody loved Martin Luther King. So he said that when he was alive, he was not loved by everybody. He was seen as a controversial figure. He was seen as a troublemaker. And I said, that resonates very well with something that I know. So the controversies about Martin Luther King were, criticism of the Vietnam War, or his confrontational stances and various other things, or he is being a secret communist or socialist. In the case of Gulen, he is charged with, like any other observant Muslim influential person, he is charged with having political ambitions. One day having the strong power, political power in the country. The civil rights movement was predominantly majority African American, but there were whites and people of various religious persuasions. And in the case of Hizmet, it was the majority Muslim Turks and Kurds, but non-Muslims and non-Turks are increasing. Their achievements are legal reform, educational reform, and attitude culture reform. In the case of Turkey and Hizmet, legal reform happened in the form of constitutional amendments to Turkish constitution, educational impact, not necessarily reform, but impact. And attitude culture reform is work in progress, as we see today in politics. So I could not compare the two in terms of these other dimensions, but feel free to ask me questions about them. And the other movements, as I mentioned, are Focolare movement, which is faith-based, but also open to participation by other participants, other religions. The Kolping movement in Germany, I believe, was rooted in Catholic community, but they served social functions. They helped workers, provided residence for them, other, and today they are diversified into many other categories. And they don't discriminate in providing services to people. They don't use it as a means of proselytization. So in that sense, they are similar to the Hizmet movement. So thanks for your time and open for questions. The effort to amend or change the constitution was a broad-based effort that culminated in the constitutional referendum in 2010. In this effort, there was a coalition of people who wanted to change the constitution, and they represented, according to the final result, 58% of the population. So the 58% basically wanted to have a democratic constitution, which is actually written by civilians. Because every previous constitution of the country were written by legal experts, but under the auspices of military generals who just staged a military coup. 1982 constitution was like that. 1971 amendments were like that. 1960 or 61 constitution was like that. So Turkish people did get a chance to vote on their constitution in 1982, but it was not a free vote in the sense that the military generals who staged the coup in 1980, they basically said that if you don't approve this constitution, we're not going away. So people either had to accept the constitution or live with the generals at the helm of the country. So 2010 actually was the first time, but the first time in Turkish Republic's history, where people voted to change their constitution without fear. The nature of the change was essentially democratic reforms, moving Turkish political system toward European norms. For instance, there was it became possible to charge military officers for possible crimes during military coups. Before, it was not possible. So, you know, a military officer might be responsible for torture, for wrongful imprisonment, for disappearances and things like that. You could not charge them. It was constitutionally impossible. This was one of the reforms. Another reform was empowerment of the minorities, women, children, elderly. Another reform was democratization of the election of higher court judges. Historically, traditionally, a handful of people elected each other. This court members elected this court, and that court elected this court kind of situation. So this was changed, and the election of higher court judges was made more broad. So it was a democratic reform. At the time, European Union praised this reform. But unfortunately, as soon as the reform was passed, the constitution was amended, the ruling party made a U-turn from their EU path. So they actually did not implement what was intended with the reforms. Freire was mentioned, and the similarities, analogies with Freire's thinking was actually studied by some social scientists. So you can actually find literature on that. And I also remember hearing the liberation theology in the context of movement as well. I think both observations are right on spot. Yeah, Zaman is a newspaper. It's a daily newspaper. It is currently the top-selling paper in the country. It was founded by movement participants. Its mission was basically what a newspaper in a democratic society is supposed to do, that is unbiased news gathering and dissemination. So it has been influential so far, and its editor has been targeted by the government, and he has been charged. Now he cannot leave the country.
Of the democracy and we hope nowadays, as you know, Islam has been pictured as not tolerant enough of another religion or another group or something. But now the movement is, looks like trying to achieve that, that through democracy we can come together with some values or something. So what's the future perspective for the movement to be able to push together with the democracy and other values, with Islamic values together?
Well, the premise of the people who gathered around Gülen was that democratic values are in resonance with Islamic values. During the 90s, Gülen made a historic speech in which he said there is going to be no return from democracy in Turkey. And he argued that when people talk about democracy as the rule of people, it is not against the rule of God, because God doesn't rule the world literally. God is the ontological ruler of the universe and the world and your life. But God does that through humans, through people. So the rule of the people should be understood not as against the rule of God, but as against the rule of, for instance, an individual or a monarchy or an oligarchy. Therefore, the rule of the people in that sense is actually more democratic, more Islamic than other forms of government, because it is based on the premise that domination can be minimized. Domination has been the enemy of observant devout Muslims throughout Muslim history by dictatorial rulers. So Gülen gave a theological argument that democracy's basic premise is in resonance with Islamic values. Now, of course, when it comes to practice, there are different forms of democracy. And every Muslim understands their values differently. But given a chance, his argument was that there's no theological barrier to embracing democracy. To the contrary, among the options, we should embrace that. Now, of course, recently we have seen more radical, more totalitarian versions of Islamic identity in the form of these groups who butcher people. So the position of mainstream Muslims, including Gülen and others and people in the movement and Muslims around the world, our position is that this is a misreading of the tradition. We cannot dismiss this problem by simply saying that they are not Muslims. They claim to be Muslim. Therefore, we have to own this problem. But this is a particular reading of the tradition, which is driven by psychological, sociological, economical, and other factors. So these people don't come to the tradition with the pure intention of seeking God's intention, but they are already bent on doing something. They are just seeking religious justification. That is our position. So we argue both from the tradition and in practice by applying these principles in our lives, by being citizens in our countries, that the ethos of Islam is in resonance with the democratic ethos. In the 2000s, we were hopeful that this could become Turkey. Turkey could be the example of a majority Muslim country which has European quality democracy, a sustained democracy. But unfortunately, within the last 3-4 years, that turned out to be a dream. We still dream that dream. We still hope that it's going to happen. It just didn't happen through the people whom we believed would make it happen. There is a perception and there is a supporting reality on the ground that at least some Muslims believe that the state or political authority should be religious. It should be colored by religion. Now, this is not necessarily a perception that matches reality 100%, but there are enough Muslims to support this perception. The view of Muslims like myself and a large group of Muslims, I don't know their numbers, is that a state cannot be religious. A state can only be a state. It is a political actor, and it has to manage the power relations in a society and should minimize the domination, which is the basic premise of democracy. So the minimizing domination and not forcing people to live in a certain way is an Islamic value. There are Quranic verses, prophetic examples that support that. So we believe that a state cannot be religious, a state can only be a state, but a state can uphold Islamic values, which are also universal values, such as not oppressing and harassing any people, not discriminating, upholding equality, including gender equality. So this is a view that is shared by a large number of Muslims, not necessarily all Muslims. So there's a group of people who still have this understanding that a state should be religious, and that gives ammunition to people who want to portray Islam as essentially a political religion. So we disagree with them, but we can only set an example. We can only show in practice. You know, in argument, I have seen many times there is no way anybody wins the debate. Very good question. So in bringing social services or medical education services to people, it is seen as insincere if you see that as a mechanism for proselytization. So going back to the concept of rıza, that is the pleasure of God, it is seen from a religious point of view as a Muslim that bringing a social service, a medical service, education service to a needy person by itself is pleasing to God. Now, when you try to impose a proselytizing atmosphere or climate on top of it, this core service becomes insincere. That means it loses all its value. So proselytization is not only, by and large, it's not done. It is actually seen as a counter to core values. And this actually can be seen in the NGOs and education institutions which operate in various countries. You can objectively actually study people who come in as Muslims and then, non-Muslims, and then when they graduate, you see that the number of Muslims don't increase. They all remain the same in the same religion. And you know, it's also possible to do a field study to actually interview the parents who send their kids. Do you see any pressure, any effect? And so far, their success shows that that has not been the case because many countries are actually very sensitive to this issue. They are more sensitive to Muslim proselytization than Christian proselytization, right? Even including majority Muslim countries. So in those countries, Central Asia, Asia, Africa, other parts of the world, these institutions have gone through multiple forms of scrutiny, and they have passed that test that they are not after proselytization. Okay, with regard to the gender question, every movement is, first of all, a product of their society, their original society. So in the movement, according to social scientists, the gender equality and gender role partitioning situation is better than Turkish society in the form of women having active roles, leadership roles in NGOs, in informal roles, having influential roles, that is, being writers and speakers that influence people's thoughts. In that sense, women do have leadership roles, but it is not at the level that is desirable. So it is better than Turkish society in general, but it is a work in progress. Your second question was, okay, Gulen as a spiritual leader today, his role is mainly for motivation for spiritual purposes. So he does not engage with the day-to-day activities of any NGO because of his health primarily and because of the size of the movement. And so far, in every institution, every NGO, every informal group, he and people around him have been encouraging consultative, collective decision-making. Therefore, you know, one day he will die. May it happen later than earlier. But when he dies, this is not going to create a vacuum to be filled because that vacuum has not been there in the first place. His inspirational role, of course, cannot be replaced, but there are many other people who can inspire people. And in terms of operational leadership, in terms of social leadership, it is already done by other people.
Right. Let's thank our
thank you for your time and effort.